Good morning. This is National BBC Radio 5, 9:09 at 6:93 a.m. In half an hour, Morning Edition with Sarah Ward. But we start the day with world news and 24 hours from BBC World Service. Radio 5. It's 6 o'clock.
BBC World Service. The news. Read by Martin Handley. President Saddam Hussein has announced that all foreign women and children are to be allowed to leave Iraq. The American and British governments are seeking clarification of the announcement. Morocco has retaliated against Iraq's treatment of its diplomats in Kuwait. The city council in South Africa's largest city has voted to end racial segregation. And that's the end of the news. And now from London, here's Tim Grout-Smith with 24 Hours.
And in the programme today, President Saddam Hussein meets the hostages again, and it appears the ordeal may soon be over for the women and children. President Bush rallies Congress behind him, but for how long? And the City of London faces up to its most damaging financial scandal. Only a few days ago, television viewers around the world watched in astonishment as President Saddam Hussein patted and chatted to the parents and children he's holding hostage in Iraq. As a public relations exercise, it backfired badly. Sickening, disgusting, and repugnant were the most frequent words in a wave of denunciation from Western commentators and politicians. But last night, the Iraqi leader was at it again, telling captive British and American families, through a translator, how their lives were at risk. But in an extraordinary and apparently unpremeditated change of heart, he promised a 6-year-old British girl that she could go home as a birthday present. Then an Iraqi television announcer said the president had decreed that all the women and children could go home tomorrow. The president had been moved by appeals from women in the group he had met. This may have been the moment referred to.
Involved.
How you can use children as a pawn in something that I don't understand.
لا يجوز إذا أي إنسان.
No, no one should cause any harm to anybody.
لا يقع إيذاؤه ضمن حالة الدفاع عن النفس وأن مثل هذا الإيذاء هو حالة الاضطرار التي ليس فيها خيار بديل.
And no one should cause any harm to anybody unless it is done in an unavoidable situation of self-defense, and there was no other alternative through which you could avoid the confrontation that may happen.
That's it from 24 Hours.
This is Morning Edition from 6:30 till 9 each weekday with Sarah Ward. Morning Edition from BBC Radio 5.
Good morning. Breakfast with the Morning Edition team and start your day in a relaxed and congenial way. We'll keep you up to date with the latest news, sport and our unique city-by-city weather and travel service. We've the best tips on high street prices and property deals. And each morning we travel across the world to join one of our sister radio stations. This morning it's Radio Tokyo in the heart of Japan's bustling capital city. And later we'll unleash the super peas on you, the pulsating Poddington peas with our own radio station, Pod AM. Stay with us. Stay ahead on 9:09, 6:93 a.m. It's 6:30 on Wednesday, the 29th of August. The news headlines with Jon Briggs.
The Foreign Office says it still hasn't had official confirmation from Baghdad that foreign women and children being held there are to be released. The announcement was given on Iraqi television shortly after President Saddam Hussein was shown meeting another group of hostages. Relatives of some of the hostages have given a cautious welcome to the news. Virgin Airlines say they have a 747 aircraft on standby to bring British citizens back from the Gulf. At least 10 American servicemen were killed when a plane taking part in the Gulf military build-up crashed in West Germany. 5 survivors have been taken to hospital. The plane came down and burst into flames shortly after taking off from an airbase near Frankfurt. Councillors in the South African city of Johannesburg have voted to abandon the policy of racial segregation in residential areas. In theory, the vote means black families can move into whites-only areas. However, the policy conflicts with national apartheid laws, and it's not yet clear whether Johannesburg will be able to put it into effect. A man has been charged with the murder of Police Constable Lawrence Brown, who was shot in northeast London early yesterday. 22-year-old Mark Gaynor, who is unemployed and of no fixed address, is due to appear in court later today. Finally, in the United States, at least 19 people have been killed in tornadoes which have struck the Chicago area. Dozens of others have been hurt, and many houses have been destroyed. Those are the headlines on the Morning Edition.
The sports news now with Charlotte Nichols.
Liverpool are top of the First Division after beating Nottingham Forest 2-0 at Anfield last night. Ian Rush and Peter Beardsley scored the goals. Manchester United and Leeds drew 0-0 at Elland Road, as did Sunderland and Spurs at Roker Park. Crystal Palace beat Chelsea 2-1 at Selhurst Park, with Palace's Andy Gray and Chelsea's new signing Dennis Wise both being sent off. England's cricket selectors now have the task of choosing who to take to Australia for the Ashes tour this winter after England drew the third Cornhill Test and won the series against India. David Gow seems to have secured his place after scoring an unbeaten 157 as England made 477 for 4 in their second innings. Britain are hoping for more medals at the European Athletics Championships in Split today, to add to the ones they won in Yugoslavia yesterday. Linford Christie won gold in the 100 metres after winning in 10 seconds flat, while John Regis came third, and Steve Backley won the men's javelin. On day two of the US Tennis Championships, there was a shock defeat for number one seed Stefan Edberg. He was beaten in the first round by Alexander Volkov of the Soviet Union in straight sets. Finally, racing. There are 3 meetings this afternoon at Redcar, Newton Abbot and Brighton. And there's a full racing preview in an hour's time.
Thank you, Charlotte. And now a roundup of weather and travel with Tony Barnfield.
Thanks very much. The weather first. Eastern districts will start dry and bright, though rather misty. But outbreaks of rain and showers over western areas will spread to all parts by this evening with local thunder. Another warm and humid day inland, but it'll become cooler and fresher everywhere. Onto the roads, the M25, the London Orbital Motorway, has roadwork severely restricting the clockwise eastbound carriageway near the Waltham Abbey Epping section, that's junctions 26 to 27. The motorway is reduced to 2 lanes on an uphill section where there are normally 3 lanes, plus a crawler lane. Severe congestion is inevitable till work finishes this afternoon. And in the West Midlands, severe congestion expected again this morning to the north of Birmingham at Spaghetti Junction, where an accident over the weekend on the M6 has led to slip road closures on the A38 between Tyburn Road and the Aston Expressway. An alternative route advised for the rest of the week. Full details in our City by City weather and travel bulletin at 7:10.
The BBC Networks Radio 5 presents the second edition of the programme for parents. Hi, Johnny Walker here, and today at 11 o'clock on This Family Business, we look at the difficulty of growing up with parents from two different cultures. My guest, Adewale Marcher-Pierce, talks about his experiences. We'll be finding out how a mother of triplets copes, and are you happy about the way women are portrayed in advertising? And if not, do you know what can be done about it? Plus, we hear from a mum who believes if your baby's keeping you up all night, it's okay to have it in bed with you. That's all on This Family Business, today on Radio 5 at 11 o'clock.
Johnny Walker, later this morning. If you're born in England, red-haired, left-handed, and as a Roman Catholic, there isn't much you don't know about prejudices. So says the man who'll be facing Dr. Anthony Clare this morning on Radio 4, in the psychiatrist chair.
Does a political journalist and historian who moves from being editor of the left-wing New Statesman and admirer of Aneurin Bevan to being a frequent contributor to the right-wing press and admirer of Margaret Thatcher really undergo a sort of psychological transformation? What fuels the passionate political convictions of a man who has done just that, Paul Johnson? He discusses this and related issues when he talks with me in the psychiatrist's chair.
Dr. Anthony Clare, who sits opposite the psychiatrist's chair at 9:05 on Radio 4. Now, this evening, the Rotterdam Philharmonic Orchestra and their conductor James Conlon performed the second of their two proms at the Royal Albert Hall on Radio 3. It's a concert of 20th century music, including Shostakovich's Fifth Symphony and Benjamin Britten's Piano Concerto, which the composer himself premiered during the 1938 season of proms. Benjamin Britten's Piano Concerto, which will be performed by Peter Donohoe in tonight's prom. And as usual, Radio 3 will be broadcasting the concert live from the Royal Albert Hall starting at 7:30. Skipping from Benjamin Britten to Woody Guthrie with limited agility, tonight at 7:30 there's a brand new series on Radio 2 featuring the music of America's Woody's Children, the singer-songwriters who have kept the Guthrie tradition alive. The programme's introduced by Tom Paxton.
And I can't help but wonder where I'm bound, where I'm bound. Can't help but wonder where I'm bound.
Hi, this is Tom Paxton, and I'd like to introduce you to my new series, Tom Paxton's America, coming up tonight on Radio 2. In my many years on the U.S. folk scene, I've made a lot of friends, some old, some new, whose music I'd like to share with you on my new series, Tom Paxton's America.
From the man who doesn't bother with shredded wheat for breakfast, just a bucket of gravel will do. Tonight's program on 2 features Rock Creek and John Gawker. No ticket required, of course, to hear Tom, just a front seat by your radio. But should you require a ticket, would you resort to a ticket tout? Do you regard them as the last chance to make it to the event of your choice, or is Harvey Goldsmith's view more accurate?
I think it's a blight on Britain, and particularly as one of the industries the whole country is pushing, and that's tourism, for tourists to arrive in this country and want to go and see the best of talent that we have here, which is theatre, which is opera, which is ballet, which is musicals and concerts and sport, and the only way they can get a ticket is to pay huge amounts of money over the top through ticket touting is an absolute disgrace.
Tout the Inside and Out, 7:30 on Radio 1, completing the Radio Network Countdown, all from the BBC.
And on Morning Edition, in just a few minutes' time, we'll be hearing about the Brazilian who's known as a martyr to the environment.
Thank you for calling the Radio 5 Talkback Service. Please leave your message after the tone.
Hello, this is Lorna Birchley, and I want to talk about estate agents. They are just the worst.
Hello, my name's Andrew, and I'm calling because I'm sick and tired of having to put up with other people's cigarette smoke on trains. Over the last 4 days, I've made 7 long journeys by train.
Hello, I'm Claire from Kendal. I wanted to phone to say how much I've enjoyed the hot summer.
Hello, this is Dave Adey. I'd like to air my views on the current appalling traffic situation in London. It took me an hour and a half to travel the...
My name's Michael from Caterham, and I'm calling because I feel that the BBC's coverage of the football last season was very much biased towards the larger first...
Hello, my name's Lynn, and I live in Abingdon, and I want to complain about the way that English is taught in schools these days. I've just started working as an adult literacy tutor, and...
Call now on 0345 909 693.
I think perhaps that's given you the idea of your unique chance to dial in and tell us what you think about all sorts of things. It can be anything at all on national radio. All you've got to do is to call us before 9 o'clock. It's to our answer phone, and we will be hearing some of those calls a bit later in the programme. And all you've got to do is to dial 0345 909 693. I'll just give you the number again, 0345 909 693. Don't miss your opportunity to say what you really feel about all sorts of issues.
Imagine you're surrounded by palm trees, orange groves, the Everglades and brilliant blue skies, and Highway 1 stretches out in front of you as you sit at the wheel of your air-conditioned Cadillac. The American Dream, set in Florida, playground of the rich and famous, and it could all be yours. To celebrate the launch of Radio 5, we're offering you the chance to fly with your family to Orlando to sample the atmosphere of SeaWorld, Disney World and Universal Studios. There are five holidays to win, with £500 spending money for each family. All you have to do is to collect the answers to five questions concerning Radio 5. For full details, look in this week's Radio Times. So, stand by for today's clue. Question 2.
We'll be open for consultations every Thursday between 11:25 and 12:30.
Those consultations belong to the health show on Radio 5, which is presented by a former BBC newsreader turned dance show host. What is her name? Now put down the answer to that question next to the four others that will complete your entry form, and you and your family could be on your way to the USA. Fly drive through Florida with 5. And a little help from Morning Edition and this week's Radio Times.
Hey, have a nice day.
Hey!
Yeah!
Radio 5's city-by-city weather and travel check begins with the north of Scotland.
Aberdeen and Inverness, high 20 degrees, clouding over, 90% chance of rain with local thunder, misty with fresh southerly wind. The Western Isles and Fort William, high 18 degrees, outbreaks of rain with local thunder, then brighter and fresher with showers, strong southerly wind veering westerly. In Tayside, restrictions on the A9 Perth to Inverness Road on the Pitlochry bypass section for roadworks are starting today. Also at Tallamine Bridge, north of Blair Athol.
The south of Scotland.
Edinburgh and Dundee, high 21 degrees, clouding over, 90% chance of rain with local thunder, misty with fresh southerly wind. Glasgow, high 20 degrees, outbreaks of rain, local thunder, then brighter and fresher with showers, fresh southerly wind veering westerly. In Strathclyde, lane closures eastbound on the M8 between junctions 30 and 29, that's Crichton and the St James Interchange, also affected the adjoining M898.
Northern Ireland and the Irish Republic.
Belfast and Wicklow, high 19 degrees, outbreaks of rain with local thunder, clearing, then sunny spells and showers, fresh southerly wind at first. Limerick and Galway, high 18 degrees, showers, some heavy with hail and thunder, brief sunny breaks, fresh westerly wind. The M22 has a contrefoe between the Ballygrooby Interchange and Artreshenham at Randallstown. And the M1, lane closures between Dunmurry Lane and the Hillhall Road overbridge.
Wales.
Newport, high 22 degrees, 80% chance of showers, perhaps thunder. Brief sunny breaks, fresh southerly wind at first. Aberystwyth, Holyhead, high 20 degrees, 90% chance of showers, perhaps thunder. Brief glimpses of sunshine, fresh southerly wind at first. The M4 has major work on the elevated section north of Fort Talbot, and there's no exit at junctions 40 and 41.
Radio 5 city-by-city weather and travel check continues with the north of England.
Manchester and Liverpool, high 22 degrees, 90% chance of showers, perhaps thunder, but some sunny breaks later, fresh southerly wind at first. Leeds and Newcastle, high 24 degrees, bright and misty, freshening southerly wind, 80% chance of showers this afternoon with local thunder. Near Leeds, the M1 reduced to a one lane each way between junctions 43 and 47, Starton to the M621 intersection. And British Rail, local services still suspended between Huddersfield, Leeds and Wakefield Westgate, but other Trans-Pennine services making additional stops to compensate.
The Midlands and East Anglia.
Birmingham, high 24 degrees, misty start, 70% chance of showers developing, perhaps thunder. Nottingham, Cambridge, high 27 degrees, hazy sunshine at first, then 70% chance of showers, possibly thunder. In Birmingham, severe delays likely at Spaghetti Junction, where the A38 access onto the M6 is closed for the rest of the week. And near East Midlands Airport, the M1, restricted between junctions 23 and 24, the Loughborough and Kegworth turnings.
The South East.
London, high, 28 degrees, hazy sunshine at first, then 70% chance of showers in afternoon and evening, possibly thunder. Southampton, Dover, high 24 degrees, misty with sunny breaks, but 70% chance of showers in afternoon and evening, possibly thunder. In Essex, the clockwise M25 severely restricted and long delays likely between junction 26 at Waltham Abbey and the M11 intersection at junction 27. London trouble spots, the A205 South Circular Road closed on Dulwich Common, severe congestion guaranteed. A503 Seven Sisters Road also closed at the St Anne's Road junction in South Tottenham, and the A406 North Circular Road, a large diesel slick on the Hanger Lane gyratory system.
The southwest.
Sorkham, Falmouth, high 20 degrees, misty and cloudy, 80% chance of showers, possibly thunder, becoming fresher with some sunshine. Bristol, Exeter, high 23 degrees, misty, bright, 80% chance of showers, possibly thunder, fresher later with some sunshine. Two lanes of the M5 are closed between junctions 13 and 14 south of Gloucester, and there's a single lane contraflow on the M50 link with the M5 between junction 3 and 4 near Ross-on-Wye. Tony Barnfield at the BBC Travel Centre.
The headlines this morning. Officials in Johannesburg have voted to end racial discrimination in the city. An American transport plane involved in the Gulf military build-up has crashed with the loss of at least 10 lives. And the main news this morning, the Foreign Office says Iraq has still not confirmed when it will free the women and children being held hostage. The time, 16 minutes past 7.
Morning edition. And he's brandishing a pot of paste. He's wielding the scissors. He's Simon Bates. What have you done to the daily newspapers,
well,
Simon?
Sarah and John, obviously the newspapers couldn't make up their minds again about what was the most important headline, because divided into fairly equal quantities are the choice of the Saunders trial case, the Guinness case, and also Saddam Hussein. In fact, if you look at the newspapers, it is a fair division. The Independent, the Daily Star, the Sun and the Mirror go with the Saddam Hussein story as their lead, and the other papers go with the Guinness trial. And even though I guess most of us don't understand what the Guinness case is all about or what it was all about, the real reason for its fascination, I think, is on the front page of the Telegraph. It's an outstanding photograph of three ladies, of Mrs. Gail Ronson and two of her daughters, looking like three stars from Dynasty, in the most perfectly cut suits I've ever seen. Having said that, of course, the behaviour of the weasels from the press from Fleet Street yesterday was quite extraordinary and quite unacceptable by any standards outside the court. One poor fellow nearly had his jacket ripped off in an attempt to get photographs of people getting into and out of cars. The actual case, though, itself, is the almost perfect combination. High finance and glamour, of course, no sex in this, which I guess limits what page 3 can do about it. But the BBC, according to Today, Ivan Waterman this morning, is hoping to sneak in ahead of the pack with The Marketing Man, a docudrama which is based on the case, and that enters production in the autumn. So I have a feeling that while the relatives of those people who've been convicted are suffering a great deal and suffering the perhaps over-enthusiastic attentions of the press, both in photographers and also in columnists, they're also going to suffer in the autumn. And I wonder about the morality of that sort of thing, because having seen your husband go down for 5 years or a year, whether it's justified or not, in the autumn, they're going to be exposed to even more with the television fictionalizations of this.
I absolutely hate these docudramas. I have to declare my interest here because I just think there are too many of them. And again, as you say, they do tread on people's toes far too early, I think.
Let's look on the positive side now. The Daily Mirror goes back to the old standards of Fleet Street and does a bit of campaigning, and a splendid story too. Siggy Jacobson has won back his missing money, but only after 16 months of agonizing struggle. The story goes back. It's a very complicated one. His troubles began when he posted two cheques for £11,000 and £1,000 drawn on his building society to a local co-op bank branch in Cheshire. The cheques never arrived, and when Siggy finally traced them to Salford branch of another bank, he ran into a brick wall. Despite dubious identification, the cheques had been paid into somebody else's account, and the cash was immediately withdrawn. End of story. As far as the bank was concerned, they weren't concerned about it at all, until the Mirror stepped in bravely. They did an awful lot of work, which is the old standard of Fleet Street, I think, and they've got a result when I think Siggy is delighted about it. He, looking back ruefully, said, "What hurt me most was that I reported the matter to the police at the beginning and then became the prime suspect. All's well that ends well as a result of good journalism, and as a result also of a little bit of hustling. Every year there is one song," says Jane Gordon in Today this morning, "that will be sung at every holiday camp knees up. This year, Itsy Bitsy Teeny Weeny Yellow Polka Dot Bikini is being sung from Benidorm to Bognor. And on the basis that Jane needs the money more than Andrew Lloyd Webber, who, of course, is behind this revitalization of a dead hit, I'm planning," says Jane, "to record a medley of the most appalling summer songs from the last 20 years. They include Tiger Feet, Seaside Shuffle, Una Paloma Blanca, The Birdie Song, Agadoo, Shut Up Your Face, and Viva España." John...
I was going to say, Hi-Ho Silver Lining was my suggestion.
Oh, but that's a classic.
Well, it is a classic, but you've seen them at the discos. They're all rowing and things like that, and you fade down the music and get them all to sing.
Yeah. I suppose if you sing it badly enough, anything can be horrible. Sarah?
Well, I happen to be living in Wimbledon at the moment, and I'm irresistibly reminded of the Wombles of Wimbledon. Do you remember that?
Oh, God.
Appalling song.
And there were Wombles everywhere. Do you remember?
Right.
You couldn't move for the darn things.
And all the kids were singing, "Womble, I'm the Womble of Wimbledon," and all that.
Let me wrap up with this morning with two pieces of news. First of all, from Today, "No One Is Keen," says a columnist, "to buy a splendid New Jersey house which boasts 4 acres of garden and a garage full of operational surveillance equipment. Ex-President Richard Nixon is cutting the price of his former home to £1.5 million, and you get all that stuff, and of course, presumably, the tape recorder doesn't work. But for sheer breathtaking arrogance, The Times, let's talk about Martin Cropper, whoever he may be. A review of Radio 5. This is not naval viewing, but it's an extraordinary piece of supposition that no newspaper should have published, certainly not a quality one. Wait for this. "Until Monday last, the BBC's range of goods might have been characterised thus. Radio 1 for housewives and lorry drivers, Radio 2 for the older generation, Radio 3 for the musically literate, and Radio 4 for radio critics. Who," says Mr. Cropper, "regularly and dedicatedly listens to radio of any description? Answer, the housebound and the carbound. The lonely, who need a constant cavalcade of human voices, and the impossibly busy, for whom an instant glance at a television screen would represent a bad investment of time and attention. And I beg the question, who would read rubbish like that?"
The last word. Simon Bates, thank you very much for joining us. Well, today we're linking up with our sister station, Radio Tokyo. In London, it's now 7:22, in Tokyo, 3:22 in the afternoon.
I'm Katsumi Kameji, reporting from Radio Japan NHK. Now I'll look at stories from Tokyo. On a river in Tokyo, a unique new leisure boat went for a trial run. It's a traditional Japanese houseboat called Yakatabune, and it's going to be presented to the city of Paris to mark the first anniversary of the sister river affiliation between the Seine in France and Sumida River in Tokyo. The boat's hull is made of reinforced plastic and measures 18 meters long by 4 meters wide. The cabin is made of wood and the floor is matted with tatami or straw mat. The ceiling of the cabin is 10 centimeters higher than on similar boats used on Sumida River, to take account of the fact that French passengers are likely to be taller. The $400,000 boat will be loaded onto a ship and sent to Paris early next month. In Paris, it will be used as a leisure boat for cruising the Seine. And on the 27th of October, there will be a fireworks display on the Seine to commemorate the first anniversary of the sister river affiliation between Tokyo and Paris. This is Katsumi Kumeji reporting from Radio Japan for Radio 5.
Now on 5, Morning Edition goes green. If you haven't yet been introduced, allow me to set the scene as we join the small green inhabitants of Poddington. The Poddington Peas, move over, Radio 5, come in, Pod AM.
I'm Loopy! Thank you, very much, thank you, and once again, it is time to loop the loop! On the loopiest show you'll ever hear, because you've just tuned into the most bizarre cartoon show ever!
The Mystery Guest.
Okay, kids, and that includes you, big ones, it's Mystery Guest time. Yes, all you have to do is guess who or indeed what our Mystery Guest is, and you could win exactly that, our Mystery Guest of the day. So hurry, 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 give us a bell as soon as you recognize our Mystery Guest. Here goes.
The Mystery Guest.
Talk, talk, talk.
Wow, that was what I call quick! Who is phoning our mystery guest line?
It's me, Zippy, the fastest pea in Poddington!
Well, that accounts for it. Okay, Zip, who's our mystery guest?
Is it Arthur?
Sorry, Zippy, you'll have to be a bit more specific, matey.
Well, half a clock.
Yeah, well done, Zippy, you noticed the missing pips. You've guessed correctly, winning yourself our mystery guest offer clock. It might not be all there, but then... neither am I. Hope your time together is well. Thanks to the end. Thank you for ringing.
Pod AM. Happy Pod AM.
Hello, Loopy. It's Happy here, and I'm standing outside the Poddington Hippiedrome, where tonight super pop star Hippy and his band are playing live. And it's a very great honor to have with me right now the very famous Hippy. Hippy, are you going to say a few words?
Yeah, right. Well, you know, it's way out and, heavy, man, you know what I mean? Dig what I mean, you know?
No, not really.
Well, you know, life's cool. Well, it's a drag, actually, but it's cool as well. You've got to mellow out. You dig me, Happy?
Well, I hope all you hippie fans, know where he's coming from. Man. And, see you tonight at the show.
Yeah. Far out.
Wow, now that hippie really is some loopy kind of guy. But right now, it's time to go over to PC Pod at the Podwatch desk.
Hey, thank you, Loopy. Late last night, Chippy's chip shop was broken into, and one of the most serious crimes in Poddington was committed. We are going over to Snoopy, the great detective, who's investigating at the scene of the crime.
Hello there, Snoopy.
Hello, Pod. Well, I'm here at the scene, and I'm afraid it can only be described as a massacre. We have two sausages that appear to have been battered, and I'm afraid there don't seem to be any clues apart from three fish fingers that look like they might be pointing towards the culprit. I'll be taking these away to be fingerprinted, and hopefully we will apprehend this saucy criminal before he fries anything like this again.
Thank you, Snoopy. Let's hope the dastardly criminal's at his chips. He's certainly at Chippy's. We'll keep you updated on that story as more information comes in. But now, right back to you, Loopy.
The Poddington Experience.
And that wraps it up.
Pod AM.
Not the chips, the program.
Pod AM.
Take care of yourselves, okay, and catch up with you again real soon here on The Loopy Show.
The Loopy Show was taped in front of a live studio audience.
Bad surprise peas. They're absolutely crazy. They'll be at it again tomorrow. Poddington Peas. This is Morning Edition. Sarah Ward and Jon Briggs setting the agenda for today, Wednesday, the 29th of August.